Two families driven to build a better world, one through politics, one through music. First, the Kennedys. See intimate, rare home movies. Then, the Lennons. John and Yoko's musical harmony and personal discord. Now, Fox Family Channel presents The Kennedys and the Lennons.
On this episode of Famous Families, The Lennons, the story of a rock and roll poet, an outrageous artist, and two half-brothers with music in their blood. But first, the most prominent, most accomplished, and certainly one of the most influential families in America, The Kennedys.
Kennedys and the Lennons on Fox Family Channel.
On this episode of Famous Families, the Lennons, one of the most intriguing musical families of the 20th century. Featuring exclusive and candid interviews with family members and friends.
And it was about an hour before the opening. It was a kind of exciting moment and everything just read. And John Denver brought in John Lennon.
Rare photos and footage of John, Yoko, Julian, and Sean. You'll discover the truth behind the relationship between John and his first son, Julian.
Yeah, I didn't spend that much time with him. I don't really know him that well as a man or as a father.
And you'll hear from John's second son, Sean, who lost his father to an assassin's bullet when he was only 5 years old.
I guess my earliest childhood memory would be watching The Muppet Show with my dad.
And take a first-hand look at the musical legacy that lives on in John's sons.
When you look at Sean, you can see he's an incarnation of his father and that there's an extraordinary resemblance. But you can see that in Julian, too.
All this and more as Famous Families brings you The Lennons. Coming up next.
The Kennedys and the Lennons on Fox Family Channel.
For most of us, it's impossible to think of John Lennon without thinking about the Beatles and how their music influenced 20th century pop culture. But if you want to understand the powerful forces that influenced John Lennon, then you need to know more about his family. The Ballad of John and Yoko Ono tells the story of a couple that was far from perfect, but which gave rise to one of the most distinctive and experimental dynasties in the history of today's music.
When we think of the Lennons, we first think of John Lennon, the rock and roll rebel whose music and lyrics inspired fans the world over. Next, perhaps, is his son Julian Lennon, who bears a striking resemblance to John both physically and vocally. And then there's Julian's younger brother, Sean Lennon, who's only now starting to establish his own unique musical identity.
Baby, I'm afraid to let you go. This don't show until the road goes slow. We're on the go like rabbits in snow.
And of course, who can imagine John Lennon without his brilliantly outrageous yet enigmatic soulmate Yoko Ono at his side? But as brilliant and memorable as the Lennons are as individuals, they're all members of the same extended family. A family that, at least as far as John was concerned, began in Liverpool, England in the 1930s, when his mother, Julia Stanley, first met his father, Alfred Lennon. John's mother, Julia Stanley, was unusual in many ways, beginning with the family she was born into.
I mean, the whole family that John came from was sort of like a matriarchal family, the five Stanley sisters, you know. All these sisters were very, very strong, and in each of the case, they were virtually stronger than the husbands. They ruled the family. They were the main strengths of the family. With the exception of John's actual mum, who was sort of, in some ways, could be the black sheep of the family.
A free spirit, Julia was quite different from her sisters and other young women of her day. She was the first woman on her block to wear pants. She also played the banjo and had a sharp sense of humor.
She was a hilarious girl and very amusing and very funny.
She had a pair of knickers on her head and a pair of glasses with no glass in. And we went in, she picks a broom up, starts dancing around, and just her whole attitude was brilliant. His mother was a total, complete lunatic.
In 1938, Julia was dating Alfred Lennon, a merchant marine perpetually out for a good time. Handsome and a bit rough around the edges, Alf, also known as Freddie, was the quintessential bad boy.
That Freddie Lennon had once spent some time in jail in Africa. He was a very colorful character. He liked to drink, and he was arrested a few times.
Within a year, Julia and Alf were married. A few weeks later, Alf was back at sea. 2 years later, Britain declared war on Germany. And a year after that, in the early hours of October 9th, 1940, with German bombs falling just outside the hospital, Julia gave birth to a healthy baby boy, John Winston Lennon. In keeping with British air raid regulations, hospital nurses whisked John from Julia's arms and tucked him under his crib to shield him from falling debris. By the time John was a toddler, Julia learned that Alf had jumped ship in America. This troubling news marked the end of their relationship. Shortly thereafter, Julia met and fell in love with John Dickens. By the end of 1944, Julia and John Dickens were living together out of wedlock.
She was the sort of odd one out, and there was all the marital problems and all the rest of that, and her going to live with somebody else. Her early life, in some ways, regarding the rest of the family, was a bit of a mess.
When John reached the age of 4, Julia's protective older sister, Mimi, suggested John come live with her and her husband, George Smith, in nearby Woolton. Mimi had decided early on that she didn't want to have children, a highly unusual decision for women in the 1930s. Nevertheless, when Julia moved in with John Dickens, Mimi felt obliged to give John a stable home.
Aunt Mimi took this fascinating interest because I think she loved more John more than if he was her own child, you know. She was John was the whole world to her, and she was thoroughly devoted.
She was very amenable and very friendly. We could always go round there for a cup of tea at any time. And of course, Uncle George, which was Mimi's husband, he had a dairy in the local village.
John's stay with Aunt Mimi was supposed to be a temporary arrangement, but this too presented problems. He was bounced back and forth between both households.
I think John really had a very difficult upbringing, to be honest, because he never had a stable background. He'd sort of lived with his auntie for a few weeks, and then when it suited him, when he wanted a clean pair of socks, he'd go over to Julia's. And, you know, when Mimi said, well, I'll buy a new shirt, he'd come back to Mimi's.
Soon, all agreed it would be best if John stayed at his aunt and uncle's home in Woolton, where his mother Julia would make frequent visits. From then on, for all intents and purposes, John would be raised under the firm but loving care of his Aunt Mimi.
Mimi put on a very strict act. She had a great sense of humor underneath when John cracked it. She took her responsibility as a surrogate mother very seriously.
2 years later, when John was 6 years old, his childhood took another fateful turn when, without warning, his father Alfred showed up at Mimi's doorstep.
John never had much of a relationship with his own father, who John always believed had abandoned him.
When his father had left, and John hadn't been told the real truth, that his father hadn't left him deliberately, his father wanted to be with him, it was that his mother had sort of split from the father.
What John didn't really understand until much later when he read his father's journals was that Freddie Lennon had not abandoned John. He had been kept at arm's length by the woman who raised John, his Aunt Mimi.
Given Alf Lennon's history of irresponsible behavior and trouble with the law, Mimi was understandably reluctant to let him back into John's life. Nevertheless, Alf talked Julia and Mimi into letting him take John on a brief father and son holiday to the nearby resort town of Blackpool. When he didn't return as scheduled, Julia tracked him down. John was then given a choice, to stay with his father or to return to the only parents he had ever known. John tearfully chose life with his mother and his Aunt Mimi. It would be 23 years before John saw his father again.
And he sort of disappeared in John's early days and never to come back until the time he became famous.
Alf Lennon was replaced by a new and more stable father figure, Mimi's husband, George Smith.
He had a special affection for Uncle George because Aunt Mimi was the iron lady around, the iron fist lady, always saying, you can't do this, you can't do that, John, you know. And whereas Uncle George would say, come on, let's go do something, you know, crazy.
George was the father figure to John, and he was indulgent with John and used to buy him things, and Auntie Mimi, I believe, used to frown at all that and everything because he was so soft with John. And then suddenly he died, which devastated John, and his first reaction when he was told, he was so surprised he was told about it, he laughed. And that was sort of like a nervous reaction to death because he could never sort of cope with death.
According to John's former girlfriend, May Pang, there were even more surprises in store for the young John Lennon.
His relationship with his mom was very bittersweet. He felt abandoned, obviously, because, you know, there was a lot of lies going on. He didn't realize that he was told his mom had died and all this stuff. And that's why Aunt Mimi was raising him. And then to turn around later on to find out this woman who was coming to visit him is his real mom.
Given his unconventional upbringing, it's no small wonder that John Lennon would develop into an unconventional young man. He preferred reading and drawing to playing with toys. He spent hours alone in his room and regularly sang himself to sleep.
He played the mouth organ. He got a harmonica that his Uncle George gave him, to my knowledge. And he used to have this in his back pocket, and we used to go to meet in the park and we'd all play along.
John's eccentricity was revealed in his writing and drawing.
He had this creativity. He used to do all these wacky drawings. You'd do a composition, and it'd have to be sort of like a scene at a market or a scene at the docks and something. He'd come out with outrageous things like drawing a big boot in the middle of the picture or something like that.
Though John showed obvious signs of being bright and talented, he seldom studied and was constantly getting into mischief at school. This was a source of endless frustration for his Aunt Mimi.
Oh, we always got into trouble. I mean, that was our trait in those days, always into trouble. And I remember John standing in the corner with his hands on his head, you know, and pulling faces when the teacher wasn't looking and that sort of thing.
John was more sort of happy-go-lucky and everything like that, and used to, practical jokes all the time, always getting up to mischief.
He was a born comic, really. Everybody thought he was going to be a comedian because he was always clowning around and very witty.
Though John's early family life was far from stable, he would hold fond memories of his years in Woolton for the rest of his life. Coming up, John Lennon finds a passion, but loses a loved one.
And who's so supportive of him in his music and what he wanted to do, and now she was taken away.
This and more when Famous Families returns.
The Kennedys and the Lennons on Fox Family Channel.
By the mid-50s, teenagers in England as well as America were defining a new culture of their own. Their role models were rock and roll rebels with wild bad boy images. It was then that John Lennon reached his teens. He was a constant discipline problem at school, was failing most of his subjects, and showed a general lack of respect for authority. He had become what British teens called a teddy boy.
The teddy boy, comic, horrific hero of the early 50s. Perhaps you remember him. The thick sole brothel creepers, drainpipe trousers, draped jacket, Slim Jim tie, greasy Tony Curtis quiff. Then there was the flick knife, the knuckle duster, and the bicycle chain. The press was full of lurid descriptions of their Edwardian clothes and vicious gang fights.
He had a sort of DA haircut, a sort of DA is a derogatory phrase in a way, but it's like the shape of a backside of a duck. And long sideburns.
John's Aunt Mimi, a strict disciplinarian, was not impressed.
John's view of life at that particular time, I think, you know, having turned 16 and sort of become to an exciting time where he's having old friends and going to the pubs.
When John asked his Aunt Mimi to buy him a guitar, she immediately refused, thinking it would lead him further down the wrong path. Nevertheless, John pleaded for months until she relented.
When I used to go round to John's house, once he got his guitar, which Mimi had bought for him, so we'd go upstairs and sure enough he'd be strumming his guitar there in the bedroom, and it was amazing because I was watching a genius working and I didn't really realise it at the time.
John's new interest in music sparked a closer relationship with his mother, Julia.
She wanted the best for her son, and having found John how musical he was, she just kept encouraging him to go on. I mean, teaching him Ain't That a Shame on the banjo is something else. I mean, How many mothers would want to do that?
She wanted him
to chase his dream, the love of music.
She was a very big musical influence on him because she, gramophones as we used to call them, but not only did she have a gramophone, but she had extension speakers in all the rooms as well. And she had loads and loads of records. She's more like a sister than a mother, you know.
When John failed his college placement exams, one of his instructors suggested he apply to art school. But by the late 50s, John had only one thing on his mind, rock and roll.
John's big influence at the time was Elvis Presley. He loved Elvis Presley. It was just the stirrings there around 58 and 59, the stirrings of rock and roll, but his love of the American rock and roll coming over from Elvis, but also this popularity of skiffle, which had been sparked up by Lonnie Donegan.
And Frankie Lane and Johnny Ray had come along, putting a bit of expression in their voices, etc. So this was really the very early birth pangs of rock and roll, if you like. And one day, I'm crossing the school field with him, and he just turned to me out of the blue and said, why don't we start our own group, Pete? And I said, well, don't be silly. You know, I haven't got a musical gene in my body. I can't play anything. And he taught me, and he said, come on, it'll be a laugh, we'll have a bit of fun.
John named his first band The Quarrymen, after his high school, Quarry Bank. Because of the good acoustics, the band practiced in his mother Julia's bathroom.
John formed the band originally with Pete Shotton, Eric Griffiths, Rod Davis, and Colin Hanton on the drums. Len Gary was also on the bass. And I used to sort of take turns also with Ivan Vaughan. And I was also the manager of the group as well for the first 2 years.
As the Quarrymen performed local gigs, they attracted the attention of a young bass guitar player named Paul McCartney. Paul later joined the band and became John's songwriting partner.
Paul came along to see us one famous day on the 6th of July, 1957. He was brought along by one of my friends, and he introduced him to us, and he got a guitar and played some tune and all that kind of thing.
That same year, John enrolled at the Liverpool College of Art. With his guitar and his rebellious attitude, his devoted circle of friends soon grew to include girls.
A lot of the girls from sort of middle-class parents who didn't want them to go as shop workers or anything, or work in factories. They wanted them to bide their time in sort of further education until they got married or something, you know? So they weren't really dedicated to art the way I felt it should be.
It was one of the happiest times of his life. He was surrounded in college by adoring fans. While at home, he and his mother had finally found a common bond in their love of music. But on July 15th, 1958, that bond came to an abrupt and tragic end.
I'd sort of gone round to John's to call for him one evening. And I got to John's house. Julia was outside with Mimi talking. We stood there and had a laugh for a while. Then I walked her down to the bus stop and said cheerio. I turned up Vale Road and I heard a squeal of brakes and a thump and just saw her body going through the air. I mean, I just couldn't believe it. I ran over and the breeze was just blowing her hair, and I could see that she was dead.
She got hit by a car, and it was hard. And it took years because, yeah, you know, he's finally realizing he had a life, he had a real mother, and she didn't die, and who was so supportive of him in his music and what he wanted to do, and now she was taken away.
But it went into a shell for a long period of time. It affected him very badly.
Shortly after his mother's death, a grieving John Lennon returned to school, but he kept his pain hidden from classmates.
He loved her very much, but he found it difficult to show his love, and it really hurt him, definitely.
But just as one woman left his life, another entered. The girl who caught his attention was a quiet and unassuming art student named Cynthia Powell.
Cynthia was a very nice girl, very pleasant, very natural, pretty girl.
She's always like, always struck me as a sort of timid girl, you know, and she came from sort of an area, what we call over the water, which is like a posher area of Liverpool.
John soon began introducing Cynthia to others as his girlfriend.
He said, my new girlfriend's coming, her name's Cynthia, I've met her in art college. Oh, she's great, you've got to see her, Pete, she's great. Come and have a look, you know, meet her, fine. So we were watching through the windows in great trepidation for this, and the bus arrived at the bus stop, and this lovely blonde got off the bus and walked along.
In the meantime, John's band, the Quarrymen, started to take on a new look.
As Paul joined, I left. So there's Colin, who was still in the band, Eric was still in the band, and now we had John and we had Paul, and Eric left. And then it was John, Paul, George, and Colin. And then a few other people came along, and Pete Best came along, and of course Ringo came along, because they were all... Ringo was George's particular friend, and George wanted him in the band. They all met and all liked him, he fitted in, and that was it.
The Quarrymen had evolved into the Beatles, John, Paul, George, and Ringo. And on August 23rd, 1962, Cynthia Powell became Mrs. John Lennon. A few weeks later, the Beatles released their first single, Love Me Do.
The best thing was it came to the charts in 2 days, and everybody down south thought, he's buying them himself, or he's just filling the charts, you know.
Other hits soon followed, and the rest was history. Cynthia soon discovered that when it came to John choosing between her or his band, the Beatles would always come first.
I mean, when the Beatles went off to see the Maharishi at Cardiff, it was there was Cynthia left behind on the platform crying while everyone went on their jolly way to thing because she was got late and delayed. She was always seeming left behind and everything.
The Beatles' popularity skyrocketed to the top. They basked in the adulation of record-breaking crowds and screaming fans at every stop on their American tour.
When they went to America, when they were in Florida, she couldn't get back in the hotel. The guards wouldn't let her in. She said, but I'm married to John Lennon. Oh, yes, we heard that from all the girls. And she couldn't even get into the hotel. I think she was sort of very sweet and everything. She didn't have that sort of strong fire that I think a person like John Lennon needs. You know, he's got to have someone to stand up to him.
As the Beatles' popularity grew, Cynthia was pushed further and further into the background. Coming up, John Lennon meets the woman who would change his life forever.
And he found this crazy woman doing crazy things with an amazing sense of humor. She had a great sense of humor, the same as John's. A lot of people know that.
John and Yoko, When Famous Families returns.
The Kennedys and the Lennons on Fox Family Channel.
In 1963, the Beatles released their first chart-topping record, Please Please Me, unleashing a powerful force that came to be known as Beatlemania. Within a year, they were teen idols and international superstars.
And here they are, fresh from their triumphant appearances in the United States. 12,000 young Britons roar a welcome. Their shrieks rise in an awesome wave.
And on April 8th of that same year, John's first child, John Charles Julian Lennon, was born. Unfortunately, John Lennon was ill-prepared for the responsibilities of fatherhood.
I think when he first saw Julian, I think that the absolute magic and novelty of it was so much that the responsibility, he wasn't aware of the responsibility of being a father because it happened so quickly. But later on, of course, you know, I think he realised it suddenly came home to him that he was a father and responsible for it. A young child.
When Julian was a baby, the Beatles were off being Beatles. You know, it was the height of Beatlemania, 64, 65. So John wasn't around much for Julian's early childhood. And as a result of being an absentee dad, he felt that he didn't have much of a relationship with Julian. And John was somewhat haunted by that.
Unfortunately, I didn't spend that much time with him. I don't really know him that well as a man or as a father.
John's rock and roll lifestyle placed a serious strain on his relationships, and his marriage to Cynthia suffered the most. Their problems were compounded on November 9th, 1966, the day John Lennon met Yoko Ono.
I did a show in Indica Gallery, and it was about an hour before the opening. It was a kind of exciting moment, and everything was just ready. And John Denver brought in John Lennon.
As for Yoko entering John Lennon's life, everything seems to change when she appeared. When I think of John, I think of before Yoko and after Yoko.
In the mid-50s, Yoko Ono, a Japanese immigrant, joined the avant-garde art community in New York, where she created temporary works of art with a subversive sense of humor.
During the concert, Miss Ono's film, Number 4, will be shown in the men's toilet of the theater.
By the time Yoko met John, she was married to her second husband, director Anthony Cox, and had a 2-year-old daughter named Kyoko. John fell instantly in love with Yoko, whose eccentric personality and unorthodox approach to life was very much like his own.
He met Yoko, who showed him another direction. He suddenly got back into art, which an art is what he was all about, and he found this crazy woman doing crazy things with an amazing sense of humor. She had a great sense of humor, the same as John's. A lot of people know that.
Within 2 years of meeting each other, John had divorced his wife, Cynthia, and Yoko had divorced her husband, Anthony Cox.
He wanted a strong woman, and that's why I think with his wife, Cynthia, if she would have been a bit stronger, then maybe the marriage would have survived.
John and Yoko married on March 20th, 1969. As a couple, they used their celebrity status as a way to promote their chosen cause, world peace, with their famous bed-ins. Unfortunately, there were those who didn't understand John's attraction to Yoko.
Well, the British press in the late 60s described Yoko as ugly. And she wasn't ugly. She wasn't. It just wasn't true. She was Japanese. And because John Lennon chose her, they sort of demonized Yoko.
I felt that the English... The English people understood my work. There was an incredible rapport between the audience and me, and even the critics, even the regular reporters, journalists, you know, they were all very kind. It went very well. And suddenly, they turned on me.
In 1971, John released his classic album, Imagine, following the formal disbanding of the Beatles. Soon after, John and Yoko turned their focus toward gaining custody of their children, John's son Julian and Yoko's daughter Kyoko. This would prove to be no easy task.
Yoko, in particular, wanted her daughter back, you know, who was living with and loved her father, Tony Cox. I think at the time, John would have copied the same thing with Julian, wanted to do the same thing with Julian, but he knew Julian had a family life. He was with Cynthia, he loved his mother, and also had a substitute father.
John's fight for Julian ended quickly when a magistrate awarded custody to Cynthia and her new husband, Roberto Bassanini. For Yoko, her courtroom battle was only beginning. After she was awarded custody of Kyoko, Yoko's ex-husband, Anthony Cox, kidnapped their only daughter. The event devastated Yoko. It would be decades before she would see her again. The stress of John and Yoko's custody battles took a toll on their relationship, and in 1972, the couple moved to New York City. The move to America did nothing to solve their marital problems, and in October of 1973, the couple agreed to separate.
I got a call in about, it would be, I think, 1975, from Yoko one day, and I sort of said, how's John? And she said, well, he's gone off. He's gone off with May Pang, who was their secretary. And he'd gone to Los Angeles to live with May, which was surprising, because they'd been so close to each other. And apparently he'd been behaving quite badly, getting drunk, and there'd been other girls and things.
Some say that during John's time in Los Angeles, he was in the depths of depression. Others believe he'd never been happier.
You know, in Los Angeles, there was a lot of stories that went flying around there, and it was the worst and it was the best. The worst year when he ended up on the front pages of newspapers saying, you know, John Lennon being destructive and got kicked out of the Troubadour. And at the same time, he had, when we were there, we did a lot of work musically. He was hanging out with musicians. Keith Moon, Ringo was there, Paul and Linda were there. You know, we had a lot of great times there.
John also began trying to build a new relationship with his son, Julian.
When I came into the picture, I remember saying to John, you know, I said, let's not have a repeat of your childhood where your father's not here, you know, and you're going to do that to Julian too. When Julian first met John, when he got off the plane, it was amazing. It was 3 years he hadn't seen his son in 3 years. So they were tiptoeing around each other. We went to Disneyland out there. We did all the things you would not expect John to do, but he was beginning to enjoy it.
John's separation from Yoko Ono would last 3 years.
And eventually he did come back again. And that's when Yoko got pregnant with Sean. So the first I knew about that was when I got a postcard from Yoko saying, "This will surprise you, Ray, but not only are John and Yoko back together again, but I'm now pregnant."
John's second son, Sean Taro Ono Lennon, was born on John's 35th birthday, October 9th, 1975. Up next, John Lennon gets a second chance at fatherhood.
He would be aware that he'd missed something that is quite important, so he didn't want to miss it again the second time around.
This and more when Famous Families returns.
Family Channel.
After Sean was born, John took on the role of house husband and father, devoting hours to caring for Sean, who he called his little guru.
Good afternoon.
Yes, good afternoon, John.
Good afternoon. And welcome to Cold Spring Harbor.
This time, it was an arrangement that worked well for everyone involved. John was in the midst of one of the happiest times in his life.
That skunk smells bad.
Not if you toast them first.
Not if you toast them first.
And put a little cheese on. Not bad at all, not bad at all.
He would be aware that he'd missed something that is quite important, so he didn't want to miss it again the second time round. So that's when John went into his 5 years of staying at home and baking bread, as he called it, looking after Sean, which he probably enjoyed more than anything he could have done. I mean, I know a friend of mine went to see him and said, "What are you doing, John? You're at home all the time." He said, "Well, I've made my contribution to society."
Daddy, don't be a joke!
Look, if your daddy's a joke, it's not his fault.
John spends most of his day upstairs in the apartment, hanging out with Sean and watching TV, occasionally playing guitar or the piano. And Yoko spent most of her day in the office, meeting with people, conducting business, and once in a while they'd go out for lunch.
Meanwhile, John's son Julian felt the sting of growing up without his father.
It was very tough to try and comprehend that in the past, to understand what the circumstance was anyway, being young and in the middle of it, and seeing that getting into my early teens, finding that he had another son that he was spending all the time in the world with. Although I did feel there was guilt on his behalf, and I felt there was a lot of anger inside of me, which finally I've resolved that.
In 1980, when Sean was five, John and Yoko went back into the studio to record Double Fantasy, his first album in 5 years.
After doing Double Fantasy, John was coming back into his own. I mean, what people don't understand is he, I don't know about insecurity, but he was really worried that people would have forgotten him.
John was also making progress reestablishing a bond with his first son, Julian.
John and Yoko had rented an oceanfront villa in Palm Beach, and they organized a big family vacation. One of the things that we did in Palm Beach was have a sweet 16 birthday party for Julian aboard a chartered yacht. And it was Julian, John and Yoko, and Sean. So the whole group hung out, and it was wonderful. The weather was perfect. And it was the last time that John saw Julian.
On the morning of December 8th, 1980, Yoko's psychic advisors warned her that it would be dangerous for John to go outside. Unfortunately, John didn't heed the warning. That night, he was shot and killed by Mark David Chapman, a crazed fan.
Mr. Lennon died as a result of multiple gunshot wounds of the chest and left shoulder.
We kind of take for granted that we're going to see our friends every moment of, you know, well, if I don't see it tonight, I'll see it tomorrow. And it was that kind of an attitude. And I said, "Well, I don't see him tonight, I'll see him tomorrow." And we went home, and I was up all night, you know, not ashamed to say, I was up all night crying my eyes out. Because I felt like it was, you know, this was a dear friend that had been taken from me. And because of that, it changed my life. Because now if I tell people, I'll be there like at 2 o'clock, I'll be there at 2 o'clock, because you never know when you're going to be missing someone else.
John's death had a sort of global impact. Everyone remembers when they first heard that John Lennon had died. It was a global thing. There were vigils all over the world. I remember huge ones in Liverpool with tens of thousands of people swarming the city centre, huge vigils in New York and everywhere.
After John's death, Yoko immediately took over John's estate and his business affairs.
The reaction inside the Dakota was very businesslike. It was, the king is dead, long live the queen. 12 hours after John died, her lawyers were in court taking care of business. Julian, for many years, received no, it didn't get his fair share of the estate. Yoko didn't pay him. And under the terms of the will, she had the right to withhold his share of the inheritance until he was in his early 30s.
One thing Dad set out in his will was that Yoko is the guardian of the estate. And only at a time later when I guess I'm responsible enough in life, should any of those monies come to me, which I'm very, very thankful yeah. for. Because I felt if I'd have had money at the age of 18, if I'd have had however much I'm going to get, which I don't know, I might not be around today. I might have done something stupid with my life.
Today, almost 20 years after his passing, John Lennon lives on in his music. His legacy also survives in his two sons, Julian and Sean. But for his sons, John has cast a large and sometimes ominous shadow.
Julian wanted to learn to play the guitar. And they would play together. John would teach him chords, and that was very touching to see, father and son sort of making music together.
What you hear of John and Julian is the timbre of the voice. It's almost like Lennon mania. You can hear Julian sounding like his father.
'Cause I believe in you, and the best is yet to come. You've been alone, it's true, Daddy's work is never done.
To Julian, the comparisons between he and his father are both a blessing and a curse.
One of the things that was the hardest to take was that I felt that I seemed to be the only person who was being crucified for using Beatle influences when there were so many artists out there that were being praised for that. That was hard to handle. I finally sort of realized and resolved those things and say, this is part of my heritage, it's built in, you know, and it's what I enjoy as part of my life, as part of what's been with me since day one.
And when Julian's first album came out, his first single, I called May. I said, I just heard Julian's new record. I got a chill that went right up my spine because it sounded just like John at a young age.
Like his father, Julian uses his fame to spotlight causes dear to his heart.
He's making statements in a way that his father used to make, and he's being a little bit more out front and up front.
The advice that he gave me was that if you have something to say, be honest and true with yourself about what you have to say. And don't be afraid of anything, don't be afraid of anyone, which is very important to me, which I've tried to stick by. And
as Julian continued his singing career, there was one more Lennon waiting to take his place behind the microphone. When we return, baby brother Sean hits the music scene.
Is that he's trying stuff on to see what fits.
John Lennon's living legacy when Famous Families returns.
You can't lose. I like that.
Over the years, John Lennon became known as a rock and roll poet and an icon for a generation. While his son Julian has been working toward the same sort of success for several years, his youngest son, Sean, has only recently set out on his own musical path.
Musical influences range from, I don't know, listening to the Beatles when I was growing up to discovering like Jimi Hendrix and Led Zeppelin and all like the 60s rock and roll music.
He's trying stuff on to see what fits. And he's got a hungry ear, and he wants to try to include everything that he likes into the stuff he does.
Unlike his famous father, Sean Lennon was raised by both parents in his early years and continues to have the artistic support of his mother.
Playing with my mom was like one of the most incredible experiences of my life. I mean, she's such an incredible artist, totally avant-garde and punk and everything that I like.
The love of Sean's life, like his father, is an older woman whose powerful artistic vision enhances his own. Yuka Honda, Sean's girlfriend, is the leader of the avant-garde band Chibo Mato.
You can hear Yuka's influence on Sean's music, that kind of the jazzy, funk-derived bossa nova from Brooklyn funk essentials and Chibo Mato that have made their way into Sean's music. I think at this point, she's probably the biggest influence on him, but not the sole influence. So I don't know that she exerts the kind of pressure on him that Yoko did with John.
Sean is Yuka's occasional bass player, and she produced his newly released album, Into the Sun.
And I knew she was the best producer because I'd worked with her on Chibo Mato stuff, so I asked her if she would do it, and she said yes.
Yuka has also produced songs for Sean's mother, Yoko, and toured with Yoko's Plastic Ono Band. Julian's recently released his fifth album, Photograph Smile.
I'm in charge of my own life for the first time, on the inside and out, and business, and, you know, so it's the first time. It's all new and exciting, and it's a lot more work, but it's okay, it's okay.
Coincidentally, the release date was the same as his brother Sean's first album, Into the Sun. If John Lennon were alive today, he would be 59 years old. John also had ideas about where life would have taken him.
John's artwork and his drawings reflect him in his wit, in his style.
I mean, I have a drawing where it's a self-portrait that how he thought he would look at the age of 64.
Many believe he would have continued to be a prolific artist and a contented family man.
If he wasn't murdered, God only knows where he would have taken music, because he was definitely an innovator.
You wonder about what that would be like if John had lived, because you wonder what cycle he'd be going through. I mean, there was nothing about Lennon that was really predictable. And you wonder if, in the end, family life would have been the thing for him, or if he would have felt a need to break out of that.
I know he's up there looking down, saying, he's laughing at us all, saying, I can't believe you guys are spending time on this, you know. But that's his humor. That would be his humor, you know, like, just make light of it, you know, because he was just a person, you know, and he felt, and he always felt that. He felt he was no God, he was just, you know, John, you know.
Meanwhile, Yoko continues to keep John's music alive. Through Capitol Records, she recently released a new box set of John's solo works. What am I doing here at all? Ain't no doubt about it. But things haven't always been easy for Yoko. The lessons life has taught her may appear harsh to outsiders. However, to her, they are invaluable.
I think that when I look back, the feeling I have about everything is that there's nothing I can change. And I would not, this me now, would not exist without all this things that happened to me. So I'm very thankful, and thankful of what I have now. I think that not just my life, but life is a blessing.
I remember when I first heard Julian Lennon's music and how amazed I was at how much he sounded like his father, John. Sean's music mirrors the same influence, but both young men have clearly moved out of their famous father's shadow and into separate spotlights of their own. But as their lives and the music of the Lennons continues to develop, it will be fascinating to see how they deal with the many challenges and rewards of their unique family legacy. A legacy that began with the Beatles and continues to this day.
We'll be right back.
on TV. Their dad is the king of horror.
When's the monster coming out?
But a real monster.
Hey, Dexter.
Is about to bring the horror home.
Where's my brother?
Julia Louis-Dreyfus, Gary Sinise, and Danny DeVito in Jack the Bear, a Fox Family movie, tomorrow night at 9, 8 central. Fox Family Channel proudly presents one of television's best love dramas, starring Kirstie Alley, David Carradine, Elizabeth Taylor, Hal Holbrook, Robert Guillaume, Jonathan Frakes, and Patrick Swayze in the story of America's darkest hours, North and South. Begins Sunday night at 8, 7 central on Fox Family Channel.